Hi everyone, welcome back to Online Classroom Cikgu Tio. We are going to look at the second topic of 2.3, that is the interaction between organisms. Well, there are a few types of interaction between organisms. There are three actually. We have symbiosis, prey-predator, and also competition. Okay, and there are also three different types of symbiosis, that is mutualism, commensalism, and also parasitism. Okay, we will look at the biggest group first, that is the symbiosis. What is the meaning of symbiosis? Symbiosis is an interaction when two or more organisms of different species, remember the word species, we talked about this in the previous video, okay, of different species live very closely together and they actually interact with each other. That relationship or that interaction is called a symbiosis. As we have learned earlier, that symbiosis has three different types. They are the mutualism, commensalism, and also parasitism. We will look at them one by one. First, mutualism. Mutualism is an interaction or a relationship that benefits the both organisms that live together. Okay, meaning they are both very happy. One example will be Nemo fish. No, Nemo fish, the actual name for Nemo fish is clownfish. Well, clownfish normally live together with sea anemone. And both of them are very happy. Why? Because the sea anemone will actually protect the clownfish so the other bigger fish cannot eat the clownfish. And also the sea anemone will also supply food for the clownfish. How about the clownfish? The clownfish actually helps by cleaning up the sea anemone. And also it provides nutrient to the sea anemone in the form of waste. Meaning it actually fertilizes the sea anemone. Another example of mutualism where two organisms live together and both of them are very happy will be lichen. Okay, what is lichen? This is the picture here. The picture you see here actually is fungi and algae living together. When fungi and algae living together, it shows something like this. Okay, so why are they both very happy? Because fungi will actually supply water and minerals to algae. So algae gets the water and minerals from fungi. How about fungi? Algae actually is a plant that will carry out photosynthesis and supply food to fungi. So they both help each other and they both live together and they are very happy. So the interaction here is actually mutualism. One more example. Myna and buffalo. Okay, Myna is the little bird that you see on top of the buffalo's head here. So why are both of them very happy? The Myna and the buffalo live very closely together because the Myna will get food from the lice that is on the buffalo's body. So the Myna will eat the lice. So Myna is happy because it gets the food. And why is buffalo very happy? Of course, because the body is now free of lice. So they help each other. Both of them are very happy. And this interaction is called the mutualism. Next, another type of symbiosis is commensalism. So what kind of interaction is this? This is the type of interaction where one organism is benefited. Meaning one organism is very, very happy, whereas the other organism does not benefit and it does not get hurt. So the other organism actually don't care. It is not very happy. It is also not very sad. It doesn't really care. Okay, so commensal is the one that is happy. Commensal is the organism that actually benefits. It has a special name called the commensal. This is where the interaction's name comes from, commensalism. Okay, so one example that happened to me, my favorite example is the shark and remora fish. This is really interesting. Why? Actually, the commensal here is the remora fish, meaning the remora fish is very happy, whereas the shark doesn't really care. The shark is not happy, it is also not sad because it doesn't actually benefit or actually get hurt. So why is remora fish so happy? Well, the remora fish is the commensal, obviously, in this relationship, and the remora fish actually get free food. Why? When the shark eats, well, those scraps that fall out of the shark's mouth will become the remora fish's food. Other than that, remora fish actually stick itself to the body of the shark, meaning the remora fish doesn't even need to swim. Remora fish actually get free transport. Wow, free food, free transport, another factor. Do you think any other fish will dare or will be brave enough to come to remora fish and eat it? I don't think so. So the remora fish actually get a free bodyguard. See, the other fish will be afraid of the shark and not go near, and hence remora fish become very safe. So remora fish of course is very happy in this relationship, and the shark is just a host. So in this relationship where one is very happy, one benefit, where the other one does not benefit and does not get hurt, it's called the commensalism. Let's look at one more example. Well, this is called the bird gnat's fern. Okay, this is called the bird gnat's ferns. It actually attaches itself and live in between branches of big tree. Why? Because they are very small plants, they're very short, and if they live at the bottom of a jungle, they do not get enough sunlight, and that can be a problem. So the bird's nest fern will live in between branches of big tree in order to get sunlight. So they are the commensal, they are the one that is very happy, the bird's nest fern. The tree, they are just the host. They don't really care if there's any bird's nest fern on them or not, because it does not get hurt, it also does not get anything. Okay, so this relationship is called the commensalism. So we have looked at two types of relationship for symbiosis, that is the mutualism and also commensalism. We are going to look at the last one for symbiosis. It is called a parasitism. This is not so happy a relationship. Why? Because only one organism that is benefited. So that organism that benefits is called the parasite. And the other one actually get hurt. It harms the other organism, which is the host. Okay? So one good example will be this. It is disgusting. This is a tapeworm. Tapeworm is a parasite, meaning in this interaction, tapeworm is very happy. It actually benefits. Why? It absorbs nutrients. It gets free food. Do you know where does tapeworm live? It lives in human intestine. It lives inside your tummy, in your intestine. Whatever you eat, the tapeworm will absorb the nutrient. So humans actually are the ones that is not so happy. They are the host, and the tapeworm is the parasite. They are the one that is benefiting. So when two organisms live together, for this case, one actually lives inside the body of the other one, and one is very happy when the other one get hurt, this interaction is called the parasitism. Let's look at one more example. It is the lice. Okay, lice also live in another animal's body. The lice is the parasite, meaning the lice is the one that is very happy. It sucks blood from another organism, that is human or animals, that is the host. Okay, so one is very happy, the other one not so happy. So we have looked at three different types of symbiosis. Let's move on to another type of interaction. It is called prey-predator. What is a prey-predator? This is when one organism actually eats the other one. So one actually die. Okay? Oops. Okay, so the prey is the organism that is being eaten. The prey is the one that die. And the predator is the one that hunt the prey. One example will be this cheetah that eats the deer. So the cheetah is the predator and the deer is the prey, because the deer die. Okay? And in this example will be the bear and the fish. The bear is the predator that eats the fish, which is a prey. And the last type of interaction that we are going to look at is called the competition. Just like the name suggests, competition, meaning these animals, they actually race, meaning they compete against each other. Why? Because they live in the same habitat and there are limited supply of basic needs, meaning their basic needs is not enough. Okay, it is not enough. What are those basic needs? They are the light, space, water, food, or mates. It can be any of them. When they are not enough, there will be competition. For example, the cheetah and the lion will be in competition to get food when there's not enough food. For example, in this case, there's only one. I think this is a buffalo or a deer. It's a very blurred picture, I'm sorry. But this prey right here is not enough for them. So the cheetah and the lion are actually in the interaction called the competition. How about the zebras here? Well, they do not have enough of what? Mate. They actually compete. There is competition with each other to get mate to reproduce, meaning they compete with each other to get a girlfriend. Okay? Next, we are going to look at something that is very interesting called the biological control. Before Cikgu Teo discuss about biological control, I want you to know that this is very, very, very important. Why? This is a very popular topic that teachers like to use in the examination. Okay, so in your mid-year exam or in your topical test or in your final year exam, even in your PT3, this is a very popular topic. So make sure you really try hard to understand this and remember, okay? So what is biological control? Biological control is a method that is used by farmers normally. They use organisms that is the natural predators, parasites, or pathogens to reduce the number of pests in an area. What do you mean, Cikgu Teo? First, please understand what is pest. Pests are animals that we do not like. They are the enemy. For example, the pest at your home will be a rat. Okay, or maybe cockroach. Those are pests, something that we don't like, that cause damage. And what we do is we use their natural predators. You know what is predators already, and you also know what is parasites. So what is pathogens? Pathogens is actually bacteria that will cause that animal to get sick. Okay, so one good example will be in palm oil plantation. People normally keep owls. Okay, they will have a few owls in palm oil plantation. Why? Because these owls will actually eat the rats. And so by keeping the owls in palm oil plantation, okay, they can control the population of rats. Let's look at a few other examples. Well, this is called the bacillus thuringiensis. Oh, that's a very difficult word to pronounce. What is it actually? It is a type of bacteria. Okay, so the farmer used this to control the pest named rhinoceros beetle. Why? This bacteria will actually produce a type of protein that is toxic to rhinoceros beetle and it will kill them. But this protein will not harm human being. So they actually use this bacteria to kill the pest. So it is called biological control because it is their natural enemy. Next is the ladybird beetle. The farmers use ladybird beetle to do what? To eat aphids, which is also another type of pest in a crop field. And finally, one more example, the duck. All right, if you walk past the paddy field, sometimes you'll see some ducks in it. Why? This farmer keeps the ducks there to eat snails or insects. Those are the pests to the paddy field. Okay, so biological control, is it good? Is it really, really that effective? Well, there are a few advantages of biological control. One very obvious one is that it is very environmental friendly because it is natural. We do not use any pesticides and there's no chemicals. So it is environmental friendly. And it is also cheaper compared to other methods. And it does not affect our health because we do not use any chemicals. If we use pesticides and those pesticides stick to the crop, for example, it gets stuck to the fruits and we eat the fruits, it can actually affect our health. Whereas biological control does not do that. So these are the advantages. But there are also some weaknesses. Okay? First one is it takes a long time before you can see any effect. Why? Imagine if you have one owl in your palm oil plantation. How many rats can one owl catch in a day? But if we use pesticide, we can kill a lot of rats in a short time. So this is one weakness. Next, the balance of ecosystem will be disturbed. Why? Because we are actually introducing a new species. One more time, this is a very important topic. So make sure you understand what is biological control, you know a few examples of biological control, you know the advantages and weaknesses, okay? So that's all from Cikgu Teo in this video. I shall see you in the next video, okay? Bye! If you have learned something new from this video, don't forget to like and subscribe.